Okay, thank you. Thanks for that wonderful, nice introduction. Let me just start the whole session on a humorous note. Normally, I make my sessions as interactive as possible. So I'll just set the base, move into a couple of concepts, and then make it interactive to find what exactly a few things mean to you. But before that, I remember the story of a young boy once who was playing on the beaches of Chennai, Marina. And while he was digging deep into the sand, he found a lamp. And out of curiosity, he rubbed the lamp and then found that a genie which came out. The genie was so happy, it said, "Oh boy, you are my master now. And I have been inside for more than 1,000 years, so I am really happy. But I want to give you one boon of anything of your choice. Whatever you say, it's my command, I will do it." The boy is first astonished. He says, "Do you really mean what you say?" He says, "Of course, yes, I've given you a commitment, you have my word." He says, "My aunt lives in Singapore, which is, I am told, on the other side of the ocean. So I want you to build a bridge for me, a road bridge between Chennai and Singapore, so that I'll be able to go and meet her whenever I want." The genie really gets upset and says, "Are you really mad? Do you know the amount of cement? Do you know the amount of materials it takes and all that? It's not going to be possible for me to build." He said, "Genie, but you said you promised." He said, "Genie, okay, I take back my promise, or you do one thing, you ask me for something else which is more possible." The boy thinks a little bit and he says, "Would it be possible for you to bring peace between India and the neighboring countries?" The genie takes a very grudging deep breath and says, "Oh boy, tell me, do you want it 2-lane or 4-lane between Chennai and Singapore?" Jokes apart, this is what actually today life is all about when it comes to peace. Not all that really easy, and this is something that people have been hankering, and it's a very good coincidence, or I would rather say an incidence, that we are actually talking on this topic today, which happens to be the International Peace Day, which Heartfulness is also celebrating all over the globe, rather observing and ensuring that many people come together for this global cause. You'll be getting some of the links and credentials later. You'll find that tonight between 8 and 9 there are a series of sessions where some international speakers, celebrities, they're all coming together and really talk about what peace is and all that. And I wish that other than going through the session that you also plug in and watch, because one, time is convenient. Second, it's a very, very dear and important concept to each and every one of us. Let's look at what peace really means. If you look at the word peace, etymologically speaking, which means the root of the word, the term peace comes from actually a French word which stands for peace, reconciliation, silence, or agreement. It dates back to 11th century. And in English itself, peace is normally used as a farewell, or especially for the dead, and as in the phrase we all know, RIP, rest in peace. If you look at the dictionary meaning of peace, peace is a stress-free state of security and calmness that comes when there is no fighting or war, everything coexisting in perfect harmony and freedom. When you feel at peace with yourself, you are content to be the person you are, including the flaws in everything that you possess. If you add a quote from the Old Testament, the Hebrew word for peace also means shalom. Shalom translates as totality or completeness, success, fulfillment, wholeness, harmony, security, and well-being. One single word called peace, see how much meaning it has. I wanted to ask a few questions for you to think, and if possible, reach out to the chat box and post what you believe would be a good answer for this. Would you like to have peace? Would you like to have happiness? Or both? What is your choice? Can you just reach out to the chat box and start putting, for example, choose one of the two, either peace or happiness. What would that be for you? Somebody is asking for both, peace, peace, happiness, happiness, peace. Peace brings everything. I'm really not sure if it does, but anyway, as long as one single piece, a piece is fine. Piece, both. Any more inputs? Peace, both. If you are peace, happiness follows. If you are at peace, okay, good. Peace. Automatically, you are at peace if you are happy. Peace brings happiness. Quite a few interesting. Peace gives happiness. I just wanted to, thanks for that quick response. I just wanted you to think about what I am going to say, whether it makes sense to you. We can have peace without happiness. But very difficult to have happiness without peace. Imagine any situation where you have looked at being peaceful. For example, if you are living in a gated community and look outside the gated community, you might find that there are people sleeping on the street, and they apparently seem to have more peaceful sleep than many people who have the best of comforts. They may not be happy, they may not have everything that they need in life. Or imagine on the other end, people who are apparently happy, you know, you get home the best of your car or something, you park on the road, you are happy and you are, you know, waving at everyone, you get out and somebody, one of the boys who is playing there, comes and makes a scratch, a dent on the car, your peace is gone. It's a very strange paradox that you can have peace without being happy, and having both is a wonderful combination. But it's extremely difficult to have happiness without peace. So the next question which daily I would like to ask each and every one of you, is peace really essential? I mean, that's obviously the topic itself that I have taken. Is peace really essential? If you really look at it, if peace is essential or not, it's a relative question, in the sense you may have your own choice. But if you look at it, actually speaking, if not for me, for the sake of others, I might need to have peace. For example, I would like to have a generation which is next to me, the generation after that, to be inheriting a more peaceful world. I have interacted with many peace leaders, many people who speak about peace, many people who work towards peace. They all say that even if I have to, you know, it's a very, again, a paradoxical statement. Prakash, even if you had to give up your life for this cause, the famous statement which even today I don't understand, you know, the mother of all wars to bring back peace. It's still very difficult to fathom even the meaning. When people say that I don't mind giving up anything that I have to ensure that the peace of the future generation is guaranteed. Peace is a collaborative effort. Is it possible for you to have peace on your own? Is it possible that you remain peaceful yourself and at work you are unable to bring peace among your team members, your other colleagues and all that? Is it even possible? Hence, like change, like anything else, peace is something that begins from us and nothing else. Peace normally, as it is perceived, works at two levels, internal and external. And even within internal, if you look at it, peace works at within myself, inside of myself, and with those who are very close to me, closely associated, closely interacting with me, maybe my neighbors. Jesus Christ said, love thy neighbors. It's not easy, because all our majority of our problem which creates lack of peace seems to be coming from those who are very close to us, specifically those with whom we interact on a day-to-day basis, whether it's our family, our spouse, our colleagues, our neighbors, or the shopkeepers where we go for shopping, or all those places. If you really look at it, true peace, though starts internally, is to a great extent influenced by those who are quite close to us. If you really look at the external peace, to which we all have to contribute in some way, and that's why you have this Peace Day being celebrated. External, I'm talking about the peace which is for the world at large itself. I wanted to ask you a question for you. For that, I want you to reach out the chat box and start posting there. At an individual level, what do you think it takes for peace to exist? What is essential for peace? Would it be possible for you to get into the chat box and start putting out acceptance? What does it take for you to be peaceful? Can you just reach out to the chat box and start typing out? I have one response there. which says acceptance. Acceptance, I guess, of ourselves and others, trying to live in the moment, letting go of one's ego, living in the moment, have no expectations. It's as close to what Lord Buddha would have said. Very difficult, but why not? Being grateful to everything, acceptance, positivity, inner peace. Yeah, the question is, what are the essentials for inner peace? That is the question, maybe, you know. What does it take to have inner peace? While there are, I am still expecting some more chat responses. Being grateful, knowing that we can't control people and situation. So being peaceful with what we have. Okay, that's a good one. Being grateful for whatever is given, maybe. Follow the seven maxim that I am not able to do. Okay, you are not alone, Sister Preeti. Okay, wisdom, harmony. I see quite a lot of responses. While there are many, I would say, building blocks which takes to be peaceful, there are a few for sure that you will agree that would ensure that at a personal level or with those who exist at a very close level, you need to have one less or no conflicts. To a great extent, conflict within ourselves, conflict outside of ourselves. Conflict to a great extent can be defined in a very simple term as a difference of opinion on any given situation. For example, your spouse wants to cook something today and you want something else. You already have conflict. And the lesser the conflict or no conflict is when peace exists, is what one theory says. The other says that the lesser the emotional turmoil, or the lack of turmoil inside of me, is essential for me to be peaceful. There are quite a few building blocks. Many of you keep sharing in the chat box. I wanted to also understand that there are a few topics and concepts for us to understand peace, which I wanted to present before you for your understanding. If you look at the global peace scenario, a lot of research papers which have been generated in the last 40, 50 years since Peace Day was being observed by United Nations, 21st September. And some of the topics that I have said are essential for global peace to exist and ensure that it continues to exist. They are saying a few building blocks. I'll go through them. One they say is security. Security of the people, security of the borders, security of the sovereignty of the country, which is what creates a tension between two countries. When your border is infringed, your place is taken, or your trade is deliberately spoiled by somebody else, or somebody putting down your country in a big way in global scene. All this is treated as a security or lack of security, which is very essential for peace to exist at a global level. They also say that development, global development, is essential for not necessarily material development, but development on all fronts. You might know that there is one neighboring country of us, Bhutan, which measures not based on GDP, but they measure based on happiness index. They find out how happy their people are. They don't worry about what their economic growth is. Not that they are not growing, but they look at it, look at development in a completely different way as compared to how normally people look at development. Normal development is always linked to GDP and economic expansion, growth and things like that. Whereas there are people, I mean, even the famous Nobel laureate Amartya Sen spoke about the Human Development Index, which is a very famous book concept for which he won the Nobel Prize. That also comes under development. They speak about allowing people to maintain their identities. The biggest challenge which destroys peace worldwide is when, for example, one religion is out to sort of either remit or sort of degrade the identity of another religion, or they capture their place, or they destroy the place of worship. When they believe, because to a great extent, people have an identity which they associate within myself, which is me, my name, my ego, what I stand for. And then a global identity to which I add some kind of a meaning. I believe that when I say, for example, I belong to a specific religion or to a specific country or to a specific community or to even a specific way of faith, when that identity is questioned, they say that global peace is not likely to happen. Democracy, surprisingly, is one building block which is seriously considered. And this is what I said in the beginning, peace and happiness doesn't have to necessarily coexist. People can be peaceful and yet not be happy. For example, there are several advanced countries where democracy does not exist, where they are economically far better off than what many democratic countries are. But yet the people who are democratically ruled claim to be more peaceful because they believe that there is a restriction, the freedom of speech, my inability to express myself, and there are several factors which determines. And democracy is considered to be a very important building block when it comes to having global peace. And conflict resolution between countries, United Nations, one of the biggest jobs is to ensure that countries don't move into war. Since the advent of United Nations, the number of wars, though there are still fights going on in several parts of the world, as compared to World War I and II, to a great extent, United Nations takes credit, or they can claim to take credit, for allowing or not allowing the Third World War to sort of happen in the world. And these are things which really happens, to get continuous conflict resolution on which many UN global ambassadors work on. Human rights, which is a very big issue globally. You know how even a small incident across the globe, elsewhere in the world, can become such a social media rage when it comes to posting, and how people respond to human rights violation, which in a way, though it's not personally touching me, I lose peace because I feel there is a sense of connection between me and someone else in the world. And when their rights are taken away, I believe in one way that my rights is only one step away before it's being taken. And hence, to restore peace, we all believe that maintaining human rights is a very, very important step. Of course, one of the most talked about in corporate all the time is about gender equity. Gender equity also globally in corporate organizations, in communities, and how people work. All this gender equity assumes a great importance when it comes to building peace. I only shared a few building blocks of what it takes for global peace. When you look at it, look at peace as a concept. I had shared a few topics which constitute peace. I am sharing a few concepts which say, for example, which constitutes peace. It's a mental disposition. Whether I am at peace or not, it's my mental disposition. What makes me upset and not be peaceful may not necessarily be making someone else be peaceful or not at the peace. So it is, to a great extent, it is a mental disposition, and it's like a set theory where we all come together in one area where we all agree that this is something which is a common mental disposition. And these were the topics which I shared a little bit a few minutes earlier. They were all common mental dispositions where everyone who were part of it felt that having security, development, identity, democracy, conflict resolution between countries, or avoid religious divides, maintaining human rights, maintaining gender equity and balance, all these were considered as mental disposition which permits peace to exist. And if you really look at it, peace, like Kaizen or continuous improvement, it's a process. It's not something that you define once and for all and say that this is peace. If you look at it, the definition of peace or how people have been negotiating peace worldwide has dramatically changed from decade to decade. What was peace 80 years back is not defined as a peace now, not because the definition has changed, but the process, the building blocks which people had, which allowed them to build peace, has changed to a great extent. And peace to a great extent as a concept also comes from the cultural values that we hold. For some people, a specific belief system which is ingrained in the DNA is very, very important. For example, you are working, say, for Infosys. There is a culture which has been built over a period of time by your founders. I still remember in 86, 87 when I chanced upon the small flat when your founders were still forming the organization. Those days I was into selling of networking equipments and all that. I still remember the meeting where I walked in, they were all sitting there, I didn't know who they were. And subsequently, we all learned who all those big names, Narayan, Mr. Narayana Murthy, and all of them. Many of them were in that small building where I walked into Bangalore and met. And the culture that they had built over a period of time in your organization, it is for you maybe non-negotiable. When that culture is touched, you lose peace. So the culture is something which is a concept. Of course, it changes from people to people, and maybe organization to organization, family to family, or religion to religion, or sect to sect, or from a community to community. But these are common building blocks where you come to a common understanding. As I said, in set theory, whatever is coming together, where you have a belief system, I have a belief system, wherever we all come together, which is a common ground, is something that we all agree on. So there are certain culture, basic cultural values. For example, respecting elders may be a culture that people who are 40 plus may believe in very strongly. Whereas the next generation may be treating them on par. So the cultural values might also change. As I said, the process keeps changing, the cultural values keep changing. So it is something that you can't have one single fixed way of saying that this is the culture, this is the problem. It will keep changing as organizations change, as countries change, as family changes. For example, when you have a mixed religious or intercommunity marriage in a family, the value systems completely change, and hence the culture also changes. It takes time for people to accept, but at some point of time it becomes an accepted change, and then you will see that in that changed scenario they would work towards maintaining culture, and through which they look at attaining peace. And finally, peace is an outcome. So if you really look at it, peace as an outcome, it's something that is a desirable outcome in almost all situations I have seen. Nobody has ever said that I don't mind losing peace permanently. They say that, okay, temporarily I don't mind losing peace because I want to look at a long-term peace. Any war that has been started, any fights that have been started, any difference of opinion that has been built up over a period of time, whether in a family or in a community or in society or between religions, between countries, is towards finding a lasting peace or an output. That brings us to a very important question. Peace at what cost? This is again a mental disposition that we have to be ready to find out for ourselves. To what extent am I ready to push myself? To what extent I am ready to pay a price? What exactly is the price I am able to pay for the peace? Because we all understand that peace doesn't come free. There are only two people who are peaceful eternally: those who are yet to be born and those who are already passed on. While you are alive in this world, peace is something that we have to negotiate to get, either inside of me or outside of me. Even inside of me, you may be surprised that I have to negotiate, because you may be wondering, how is that I need to negotiate with myself? For example, I have a set of belief system. I move into a working culture for the sake of my material and professional progress. And I find that the first thing people say, wow, I went to this organization. My daughter used to work for an MNC. I am talking my own daughter. And she came back on day one, she said, it is a cultural shock, because the way they were talking, the way they were interacting, is not how I have been brought up. Which means even there, peace at what cost? And then it took her some time to understand that, okay, this is the way this specific organization works. And this is the way I need to mold or rebuild myself. Okay, there is a cost that you have to pay. Is it worth paying or not is a call that an individual has to take. Are you right now peaceful? Whatever you are currently following, does it offer you a permanent peaceful proposition? Even assuming if it allows you a permanent peaceful proposition, will it be possible for you to sustain that continuously over a period of time? These are questions you have to ask. Then the antithesis of that question also comes to us. If there is no peace, at what cost do we lose peace? First we looked at peace at what cost, and then we looked at if there is no peace, at what cost do we have to lose peace? This is something that we have to be careful. For example, very simple example. Peace at what cost? Everyone sleeps at 11 o'clock in the home. If I sleep at 9:30, the noise is still there. So, okay, I also realign myself to ensure that either I go to bed at 9:30 and do whatever I want. I pray, I clean, or I read books, listen to music. And when the lights are off, everyone switches off, I go to sleep at 11. Or I go and start fighting with them. make them all to come back and sleep at 9:30. I'm just giving you a very simple example which even happens at a home level. You need to decide peace at what cost or no peace at what cost, which outweighs other, which outweighs at each at what is your take on this? You want peace at any cost or you want peace at a cost that you don't want to be? It's something that you need to decide. Before I move on to the final segment, I will take another 5-10 minutes and maybe make a poll with you also, or a chat box interaction. I want to give you two famous quotations that I have read which impacted me heavily when it comes to peace. The first is from a book called as The Peace Warrior by Peace Pilgrim. She's a lady who has been walking all over the globe, spreading the message of peace. She gave a beautiful take on what peace meant to her. Let me read it out for you. The simplification of life is one of the steps to inner peace. Very beautiful opening sentence. Huh? The simplification of life is one of the steps to inner peace. A persistent simplification will create an inner and outer well-being that places harmony. Am I audible now? Okay. Only it happened now or a little bit earlier? I will then start reading that quote again. The simplification of life is one of the steps to inner peace. A persistent simplification will create an inner and outer well-being that places harmony in one's life. This is what the Peace Pilgrim's definition or famous quotation is. The other quotation I picked up from Wayne Dyer, who is one of my favorite authors. There are several of his bestsellers you may be able to read. He has been writing since the 80s. And he has influenced a lot of my thinking in my early days of my career. I have been in behavioral science and all that for about 3 decades plus now. One of the quotes that he said on peace is like this. Peace is the result of retraining your mind to process life as it is, rather than as you think it should be. Extremely profound quotation if you understand. I mean, it exactly connects back to what we do at Heartfulness Institute as well. Let me read this quotation again for you. Peace is the result of retraining your mind to process life as it is, rather than as you think it should be. So obviously there could be questions which comes up in your mind. Does it mean that I don't look for progress? Does it mean that I don't negotiate for a better being on any plane? If you really go back and look at it, he also speaks about finally your mental disposition. One of the things that people put in the chat box response initially, they all said that many people had said, if I remember, that peace is acceptance. And that's what he beautifully says, that peace is the result of retraining your mind, which means your mind one needs retraining. He doesn't say training, which means we all have been trained in one way or another to become what we are. Our mind, being the black box that it is, has picked up so many things which has put inside of itself. He's saying retrain your mind to process life as it is. Accept life as it is, rather than as you think it should be. The challenge, according to him, the internal conflict to a great extent comes from your inability to reconcile what you are to what you want to become on a consistent basis. While my interpretation is that it is perfectly all right for you to strive to become better and better in the material life, acceptance at the end of the day, I remember interacting with a very big CEO in the Indian top 20 organizations. When it came from me, it was really surprised. This happened about maybe 8 to 10 years ago. And he was saying something like, Prakash, at the end of the day, my conscience need to be clear for me to have peaceful sleep. Very powerful statement. One, he said, peaceful sleep is essential. And he said, my conscience has to be clear, which means unless I am able to accept what I do, or unless I am able to retrain my mind to accept what I am doing is right, my conscience cannot be clear. Those who are familiar a little bit with heartfulness practice will understand that guilt is one of the biggest samskaras or impressions to clean up. Because the moment I have the feel of guilt, See, the other impression that you build in the process of spiritual process is easier to clean off. If it's a wish for a better life, or your impression that you form for getting better material possessions, is something easier to clean off. When it comes to guilt, oh, I shouldn't have done it. I feel bad that I let this person down, which leads to forming of guilt, or point D, as they say. Makes it much more difficult. In fact, it is said that even God cannot clean, and you need to work upon yourself by the process of bedtime prayer and all those things for you to clean off the impact of guilt. If you look at heartfulness, what does heartfulness do in the process of peace? What is our space? What is that we contribute in? I still remember a portion of the letter that Babaji Maharaj had written to United Nations, where he offered to bring peace by bringing peace to the individual. By my take, let me share my personal experience. Nothing like speaking from experience. My 28 plus years of experience of doing this meditation and the associated tools, this is what I wanted to share. By allowing a person to learn to be peaceful under all trying circumstances, heartfulness meditation offers world peace a true chance. This is my definition. I have not borrowed from, I am not reading from anyone else. This you can ascribe to Prakash. By allowing a person to learn to be peaceful under all trying circumstances. This is exactly the charge. Right from the time we get up in the morning till we go to sleep in the night. See, none of us look for peace when we are asleep. But peace is essential for you to be asleep. So all trying circumstances meaning you want to be something and somebody is pushing you to be something else. You want to do something, somebody is pushing you to do something else. All these are trying circumstances, conflicts. That's why they say, you know, when you are torn apart, the famous classical example or the definition, when you are being torn apart really means my heart says something, my mind is saying something else. My heart says be content, this is sufficient for you. My mind is saying you are capable of achieving more. The trying circumstances need not come from outside alone. It all, the seed all is coming from inside, from trying circumstances. Heartfulness meditation offers world peace a true chance. I am not saying this is the only way. I am saying that this offers peace a true chance. What do we do? Those who have already practiced the elements of heartfulness practice, you all know, at an individual level, we work towards, through the process of the tools and techniques, through the concept of 10 maxims, through the process of calming your mind under all circumstances, through the process of offering you spot cleaning whenever your mind is under emotional turmoil. This is something that has been of a great boon to me in my personal life. I go through very trying circumstances because I work towards bringing a balance between my material life and my life which I use for heartfulness. And I spend more than 70 to 80% of my waking hours in spreading the message and talking about heartfulness because I believe it helps. But in that process, there are several challenges I need to overcome. And at each of these points, what has kept me hooked to the ground? What has kept me grounded? What has kept me devoid of major emotional turmoils? Has been the process of meditation, has been the process of relaxation that has been taught, has been the process of spot cleaning that I have been taught, and the prayer which helps me to connect to the source whenever I choose, specifically in the morning when I wake up, when I go to bed in the night. I want to ask a few questions before I pause this session to take into question answers. There are a few questions I want you to think. At an individual level, I wanted to think and answer for yourself. You don't need to put in the chat box because we may be running short of time. At an individual level, what disconnects us from inner peace? This I would call in management parlance as a root cause analysis. For each person, it may be different. If I know what is disconnecting me from inner peace, it may be different for somebody else. It may be each and every person, like fingerprints and prints that I have in my hand. Each one is unique. Likewise, what disconnects me from inner peace may be different for me and different for you. Some of the answers, let me give you common answers. You may pick up whatever you want. One of the biggest disconnection which happens is prejudice. Prejudice is such a huge topic that I have run sessions on it for 1 or 2 days. It's such a huge and big topic, to put it very simply, the baggages that we bring from the past to determine about a thing or a person or an event in the present circumstance. Which means I'm judging something before it happens based on what I have gone through in my past. What are those past baggages are? Malice, jealousy, conflicts, many other past baggages that we have. All of that is something that disconnects us from inner peace. You make a choice. If you are able to find, you have created at least the first step to create permanent inner peace, and that's the beginning of, say, world peace. And what does it take for you to maintain inner peace once you have found what the actual challenge for you, which disrupts your inner peace is? You need to find again what works for me may not work for you. For me, maybe meditation works. For me, cleaning works. For me, prayer works. For me, following 10 maxims works. For me, accepting people cheerfully, accepting situation cheerfully works. It may not work for you. For each one of us, we may have our own playlist and jukebox from which we have to choose the records to play. It's up to you to find. For some people, allowing others to win over them is perfectly fine. For somebody else, winning is what brings peace or happiness. And it's up to you to decide. How do you want to achieve this? So I have asked you three pertinent questions. What is that which disconnects you from peace? What do you think you are going to do about it, and how are you going to achieve it? If you look at it, as I mentioned, we offer multiple choices in Heartfulness Institute. Right from the time that you relax, within a couple of seconds you will find, as we go through the relaxation process, in all probability after this session is over, when our trainers actually may be taking you through the process, they might also use the concept of relaxation. I am not sure if it is part of the agenda today. You will find that in less than about 5 to 10 seconds, it takes you to the deeper states of consciousness, where you are able to instantly connect to the source. And as you flow through the relaxation, you meditate. And as you meditate, you will find that the peace is something that you can bring at will. That is something that I have found. Anytime I just close my eyes, go inside of myself, I am able to connect to the source. If you look at the management parlance, if you see a larger picture, the two-line theory, as I call it, you know, if you want to make a line which is already here short, you don't need to rub it off. All you have to do is draw a bigger line next to it. So something like that, we also draw lines which are larger by going inside, connecting to inside, connect to the heart through the process of meditation. And in the evening, the daily, the residue which forms inside of me through the impressions and the challenges I face, I do what is known as rejuvenation or cleaning, through which I remove the accumulated dirt. Like many of us would do when we come back home, we need to clean up our house, we need to clean up our table, we need to clean up our mess that the house is in before we can go to sleep or go to rest for the day. Likewise, we need to clean up the inside of ourselves too. And before we go to sleep, we do what is known as a prayer. And of course, we have the 10 maxims and many of the other guided practices. These are things which are available to you free 24/7 anywhere. We have more than 15,000 trainers globally and in more than 160 countries. We are doing a lot of building blocks of bringing peace to you first, the inner peace, through which we take you towards a global peace. I hope in the last 35 to 45 minutes of a short interaction with you, I have shared some of the building blocks in giving you insights on what is peace, what it takes to be peaceful at a global level and at an individual level. What are the building blocks that I need to create? What are the blocks I have to remove inside of myself to create peace? And some of the tools and techniques which are available. I park it here right now, and I thank Infosys for the opportunity given. If there are any questions, I would like to throw it open now for me to take it from you and answer. Thanks.